Shalom and welcome to another weekly Bible study as we continually rightly divide the word of Yahweh as a workman. Now, in today's study, we're going to continue in the path of our last few studies as we move into the seventh month and the fall feast. And in our last Bible study, I was talking to you about the two witnesses and Christ returning there in Hebrews 9:25, 6, 7, and 8, and how that lined up with who the witnesses are, being the beloved John and also Elijah. Now, a lot of people think Moses is one of the witnesses. Now, when you're looking, and when we were going through the verses in 9:27, it says, it is appointed once the man to die, talking about the two witnesses. I don't know if I brought that once. In other words, it made sure that the Hebrew writer that wrote that, it is appointed once, not unto man to die, the man, definite article, which represents the two witnesses. Because as we pick it up from there and go on to this study, we'll see this is the mystery of God in Revelation 10:7. This is where we're going to start, and we're going to look at some words that Paul used when he's talking about the mystery. And of course, everything, as I've told you before, as the Lord has brought this Enoch calendar in, today would be the 12th day of the sixth month, Thursday. And on the Gregory calendar, or Gregorian calendar, would be September the 1st. September the 1st, 2016, the Enoch calendar would be the 12th day of the sixth month. So very important there for those that are keeping up with the Enoch calendar, because as we get closer, we're going to bring in the two witnesses. We're going to show by the Enoch calendar that's coming as I build up and lay this foundation as we come into the seventh month. You will then see, according to God's calendar, the Enoch calendar, the two witnesses, what date they will actually come on the scene according to the feast. And we're not talking about which season of the feast, or what year of the season, but we're talking about the feast day that they will stand up to start their prophecy. And then 1260 days later, exactly according to the calendar, the beast will overcome them and kill them, and they'll lie dead for 3.5 days. And then a great voice from heaven as a ruach breathes in them, they stand up. And we will show all of that. And this is all, people, for those that are following Christ and the mystery now. They're, again, very important. That's why Paul used the word mystery probably 20 different times. It's found 27 times in the Renewed. Christ used it first in Matthew 13. So it's very important, and this is, you're going to see as we go through some of these verses, that for those that have eyes to see and ears to hear, it's very important, because this mystery is also talking about the mystery of the gospel, the mystery of God. We'll see all of that. Very important. Now, this is prophecy towards the mystery, people, of the kingdom. This is not, there again, this is not him calling his people back when he gets here to fulfill all of the prophets' prophecy. That's not a mystery. So we got to teach things in the order of how he lays them out. So when we get into this, for those that are confused over this, or you don't see this, I think that going over some of these verses is going to help you see that there's two different things. We are resurrected at the last day of that year, when that trumpet sounds, we are resurrected at sundown, or when the sun sits on the horizon there, that's at twilight. That means twilight is that sun goes down below the horizon. Not when it starts down. There's a small, brief time, but it sits on the horizon. And that's when Paul says, that's the mystery. We will all be changed a moment in a twinkling of an eye at the last trump. And, of course, the will of the Father is to redeem the times and follow Christ through his divine holy days. And then those that endure and do that, the promise of the Father is to send the Son to resurrect us at that last day. That's the mystery. See, so we're trying to bring this out. Let's pick it up here in Revelation 10:7. And this is John now. But in the days of the sounding of the seventh angel, when he's about to trump, it's talking about the seventh trump, he should be initiated, or completed the mystery of God, which is the good news. This gospel of the good news was announced by his bondmen and the prophets. So very important, this mystery. And when this seventh trump sounds, this mystery is completed, people. But we're not changed at the seventh trump. We're changed at the last trump. That's part of the mystery. And as we get into this, I'll show you what the difference is. Okay, now, and the voice which I heard from the heavens again spoke with me and saying, go take the small scroll, the one being opened in the hand of the angel standing upon the sea and upon the land. And he went forth to the angel saying to him, give me the scroll, the small one. And he says to me, take, devour it, and it shall embitter you in your belly, but in your mouth it will be sweet as honey. And I took the small scroll from out of the hand of the angel and devoured it, and it was in my mouth as sweet honey. And when I ate it, my belly was made bitter. Now notice what the angel tells John, the beloved John here, people. And he says to me, it is necessary for you again to prophesy over peoples and over nations and languages and kings many. Now, John is on the island of Patmos, and he's telling them this word necessary right here, it means necessary or binding, behooved, meet, must needs, needful, or should. So this was very, very important word here, and I'm going to show you how it's used in some other places. Now, it is necessary for John, again, to prophesy over peoples and over nations and languages and kings and many. Now, people, when you go to the 11th chapter of Revelation, if you pick it up in that verse, the last verse of the 10th chapter, and you see, and was given to John a reed like a rod, and the angel stood saying, arise. Now this word agero is used in the resurrection. It's used when the many saints that slept arose. It's the same word. So John and Elijah will rise as they measure the temple of God and the altar and the ones doing obedience in it. Now, very important here, people. I want to bring out a couple of things so you need to see a little deeper in the scripture. Why is it John that is told to measure here? And he's told to go prophesy. Now the other, we already know, the other witness is Elijah. Well, right here, he's penning, and it's necessary for John also. So John is one of the two witnesses. I showed you that in the last study, but I wanted to bring it further and give you another proof. Right here, he tells the angel, which is the Messiah. The Father reveals to the Messiah, the Messiah is revealing to John, and John is penning the unveiling of the Messiah. That's what this is. And so the Lord has told John, you're going to prophesy again. Now, what did he tell his disciples in Matthew 17 John 20? What did he tell them? Peter, you're going to die this way. Some of you are going to die like this. But if John tarries till I come in my kingdom, what is it to you? Follow me, Peter. Don't worry about it. In other words, you follow me, you do what I say, and John's going to do what. But if he tarries till I come, so he's telling you here, John is penning this Revelation 10, and the Lord is telling him, hey, John, you're going to go prophesy again. But that hadn't happened yet. See, we're real close to those witnesses standing up, and they will prophesy. And guess what? According to the authority of the scripture, they'll die just like Christ said. So John is the one. Now, what I want you to see in verse 11:1, John is the one to measure the temple. Now, a lot of people out there teach that this third temple is going to be built. They might try to do that, but if they do, it is the abomination. Now, a lot of people think the abomination is when they build the third temple, then the man of sin goes in and sits in the temple saying he's God. We are now the temple of God, people. We are still in the administrative time of the assembly being called out. So when Christ gets back, the temple of Ezekiel's temple will be built, because the Torah, we will be in the land, and the temple, the sacrificing, and all nations coming to keep the feast or learn the Torah, that will take place in that day when he comes back. This is before he comes back. So this is their last 3.5 years of prophecy. So we are still the temple of Yahweh and the temple of the Holy Spirit. And notice, when you look here in this, when he says, all right, now this is a picture. On that day, I'm going to give you the day, not today, but I will give you when the two witnesses will stand up. On a feast day, we will show that by the calendar. But this is a picture of coming prophecy, John is to measure the temple of God, not the temple, the God. Now, who is the temple of God? Paul reveals that. We are. So how does he measure the temple of someone that's the temple of God, and the altar represents your heart, your understanding? We give our body a living sacrifice. We are the temple and the altar. Measure the temple and the altar and notice, and those that worship therein. This is not talking about Orthodox Judaism building a literal temple and then them setting up sacrifices. That will be an abomination. Now, a lot of your Hebrew people and stuff understand that, but I'm trying to show you that we're still under the administration of, when Paul says, when the fullness of times comes, he'll gather all things in heaven in Christ and all things on earth in Christ, and that hadn't happened yet. The fullness of times is the fullness of his moeds. We haven't even got 3.5 years. The witnesses haven't even stood up. So this is when they stand up. So he's not talking about a literal temple. I know that's going on, people. I know the temple institution is going on. But you got to understand, why is John doing it? Because John comes under the renewed covenant, and we, in this dispensation or administration of grace, we worship Yahweh. And our master, we worship in spirit and truth. So he's talking about the measure those that worship therein. In your temple, you're worshiping in spirit and truth. It's a Jewish understanding, but you got to understand at this time we're the temple. The real temple, or Ezekiel's temple, will not be built till the Messiah gets here, people. So there again, those people that follow that. Now, I'm going to say this third time. I did not say they wasn't going to put something up over there. They're already hoping that they're I seen this week that they've already picked a high priest. So they can do that, but here, when Christ said, when you see the abomination of desolation that stand in the holy place, then all in Judea get out. Well, that's what I'm fixing to say is, goes against all of that other prophecy out there. Because that what they don't understand, that John is measuring those that worship in spirit and truth. Not a temple that's going to be built, and in the middle of 3.5 years, the Antichrist is going to go in and sit down and say, I'm God. That is false teaching. Now, be as it may, let's continue, but that is false teaching. And I will give you a clue here. Well, they stand up in sackcloth. That's a huge clue to what day, feast day, they stand up. But I'm not going to give that now, because when I give that, I want to show you by the calendar how correct the calendar, and when they stand up and prophesy, how correct the God's calendar is. It's perfect, people. Now, so let's continue. I wanted you to see this, that John is the one measuring. He is of the renewed covenant. Elijah wouldn't be told to do this, people. He represents the old covenant. I will make a new covenant, a refreshed covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. When John is doing this, this prophecy, we hadn't even got, this is starting of the last 3.5 years of the mystery of God will be completed. So whatever they do over there, if they put up a temple and with the high priest that's already been set, they said they've already appointed him. They're supposed to have all this stuff ready. That's fine. But when Christ said, when you see the abomination, because to sacrifice any animal at this time, before the mystery has been fulfilled, then that is what Christ is talking about, is an abomination. Because Christ was cut off in the middle of the week, and he cut out the oblation, the sacrificing of animals, people. That's when he died in the middle of the week. That's when that ended. And 40 years later, the temple in Jerusalem was destroyed. Just like he prophesied in Matthew 24 and verse 3. So very important. We got to stay in the parameters of that we are still worshiping Christ and by being the temple of the Holy Spirit, the temple of God, in spirit and truth. Very, very important. Now, when I talk to you about this word necessary, so what I want to do real quick, then we're going back to the mystery. What I want to do is I want to take you to a couple of verses. Let's go back to John 4 so you can get a foundation of what this word necessary means. And let's look in John the 4th chapter. This is used several times. I'm just going to use a few verses so you'll be familiar with it on the word necessary. Now, John 4:4, but he, Christ, needed to pass through Samaria. This word needed here is the word in the Greek, is the word necessary. In other words, here's the word. 11:63. There again, I said it's necessary, binding or behoove, you must meet. So he must, Christ must, he just didn't go to the woman at the well in Samaria one day looking for a drink of cold water. He went because it was necessary for this to be fulfilled. All right, let's look in the next one. Let's drop down here to 4:24. John 4:24. We'll see this word used again here. Okay, now this is very important. God is spirit, or Yah is spirit, and those who worship him, here we go, those that worship him must worship in spirit and truth. Now, the polyglot uses doing obedience right here, obedience. So that means fully, as a dog would lick his master's hand, prostrate oneself, do high reverence to, adore or worship, prosukamai. All right, now the point being is, this is the same word now when you go back to right here. This is why I'm trying to show you this. When you go back to Revelation 11, we're giving him a reed measured like a rod, and stood the angel saying, arise and measure the temple of Yah and the altar, and the ones doing obedience, or this word is the same word, prosukane, and that means like to kiss a dog licking his master's hand. It means to crouch, prostrate oneself in homage. And guess what? We do that in spirit and truth. So John is revealing this, what Christ said, that we must do, the ones that are worshiping God in spirit and truth. We must do this. This is necessary. Here's this word must, people. Very, very important. These words are so very important. So I'm trying to lay a foundation and show you, when Christ taught this in John 4:24, now you've got John measuring. This is a idiom. This is a Jewish idiom of we are now the temple of God and the temple of the Holy Spirit, which Paul says, and we worship in spirit and truth. See, and then it's necessary. I mean, if you're not, then, see, that word necessary, we have to do. And this is doing the will of the Father. And of course, when you study that further, that means to redeem the times. That means buy back the Sabbath and the holy days. That's doing the will of the Father, and the promise from the will of the Father, that we will be raised at the last day, at the last trump. That's when we will be raised and changed. And that's the mystery. Now, the other part of that is when Christ sets his feet on the Mount of Olives in that day, then that seventh trumpet blows and the mystery is fulfilled. It's complete. There's no more delay. So you have the resurrected saints, just like he said, Luke 20 verse 35, if you're found worthy in the resurrection, you don't die anymore, you're like the angels. And you'll be called the children of the resurrection. But then you've got those that he's going to gather, the remnant of his people, the outcast of Israel. And it will all be back in the land together, and that mystery will be completed. The heavenly and the earthly, and I'll get into that in a deeper way as we come into the fall feast. Okay, now, very important understanding this word necessary, and how you're seeing that John is measuring those that worship in spirit and truth. But he's using the temple language. But people, there again, the Ezekiel temple will be built when Christ comes back. And I'm not saying the Temple Institute over there will not try to put a temple into place. But when they do, I'm telling you, that will be an abomination. That's the sign. That will be an abomination to God. Because we are still in this period until this administration period is completed. Then we move in to the millennium when the Ezekiel temple will be built. So if they're trying to build something before that, then they're taken away from the book or added to the book. That's what I'm trying to say. Okay, now a lot of you people out there that believe that other prophecy, that's fine. Yeah, we'll just hang in there, because there's many places in Ezekiel that tells you, and of course that day is also there, also tells you when a temple, Zechariah tells you when the temple will be built, not just Ezekiel. So I hadn't got into that yet either. All this is coming. So that's why I'm very, very confident of what I'm saying. Not because I got a vision. It's because I've already seen it in Scripture. So when you get that Scripture, then you can, that's what we're supposed to do, teach Logos in season, out of season. Okay, so let's look at another one here. Let's go to one very interesting here, John 20, verse 19. Okay, let's look at John, 20, not 19, 20, verse 19. Now, let me put it in the Messianic translation. This is a Tree of Life translation, a Messianic translation. Okay, verse 19. I think I've got the wrong. When the doors are locked, disciples. This is after the resurrection. And this is actually on the Sabbath, not the first day of the week. I have taught that. I want to give you this verse, people. It's very, very important, but I wrote the wrong verse down, so I'll have to just bear with me. Let me look this up. I'll show you how you can see how I actually find or do these study words. I'll go back to John 4:24, and I'll do a right click on must. Look in the New Testament, and we see it's used 103 times here, and I'm just picking out a few. So let me get over here to John. Bear with me just a minute. Let me find. I want this verse is very, very important. You see this? It's Luke's account. Luke. Let's see. Let's get in John here. Okay. Yeah, there's a lot of good verses. You need to go look all these up. I just don't have time to read them all, but it's a real good Bible study to go look up this word necessary in the New Testament and go through all the scriptures, and you'll get a real good picture of this. And this is one we looked at. Okay, I was 10 verses off, I'm sorry. It's John 20, verse 9, I had 19 down there. But it didn't take but a minute to find it. So John 20, or St. John 20, verse 9, for not yet they knew the Scripture. Now, notice here, the Scripture, what does this refer to right here, people? This is talking about the Old Testament. Whenever you see this, there wasn't no canonization. They hadn't even wrote the Gospels. This was early in Christ's teaching. This was after the resurrection. But for not yet they knew the Scripture that it is necessary. Here's this word necessary right here. G 11:63, for him to rise up or resurrect from the dead. Now wait a minute. So not they didn't know the Scripture. See, now this is Old Testament Scripture. That it was necessary for Christ to be raised from the dead, to rise up from the dead. Okay, now, I've done this with some of y'all out there before, and I think this is good. When y'all look at John 20:9, if you don't know where this is wrote in the Scripture, the Old Testament, email me or make a reply. But I think this is good because we get to correspond with each other, and this is a very, very awesome verse that everybody needs to know. This is part of the mystery. So, but they didn't understand this, people. That's what John is right. They didn't know that this was in the Scripture. Not about his resurrection, but rising from among the dead when the graves broke open. You got to remember, there was many saints asleep when Christ died and the earthquake hit before he was ever put in a tomb. They were laying there ready to come up out of their graves, people. But they did not come up till after Christ's resurrection, 3 days and nights later. So where was this prophesied that Christ would be raised among the dead? So see if you can find that in Scripture, and if not, email me or what, and when I bring up the next Bible study, I will give everybody, or those that don't know this Scripture, I will give them the Scripture. Okay, the last one we're going to look at, Revelation 20:3. Okay. Revelation 20, this word necessary, this, I'm just giving you a few of them, giving you a foundation here. Now, of how important this word is. So let's look in verse 3 here, and we'll go back to the Messianic translation. And he cast him into the abyss and did shut him up and put a seal upon him, I'm talking about Satan, that he may not lead astray the nations anymore till the 1,000 years be finished. After this, after these, it behooved him to be loosened a little time. Okay, this is necessary for him. If you're looking at the King James Bible, it says, and after this, he must be loosened. Right here, must be loosened a little season. So this is how important this word is. So understanding that, then when Christ told John that he had to go again and prophesy again to many nations and tongues, languages, kings, many, this, he must do this. That's that same word as these other words. Very important. And it has not happened yet, people. So hopefully, as we tie in Revelation 11, back with Hebrews 9, 25, 26, 27, 28, Revelation 10, the mystery, this is what this is about. It's about to be completed. It's about to be finished. It won't be a mystery. It will finally be fulfilled. And also, as we go back, when Christ told in Matthew 16 chapter, some will not taste death if they see me coming in my kingdom. And then John 20, he tells Peter how he's going to die. And Peter wants to know how John's going to die. And he said, if he tarries, And then we see the Hebrew writer filling in that for us, and then John reveals this in Revelation 10, and then start Revelation 11 as they get ready to prophesy in sackcloth for 1260 days or 3.5 years, 42 months. Okay, now back on the word mystery, the mystery of Yah, Revelation 10:7. So let's look at a few verses before we close, so I can lay this foundation. And this is what this teaching is about, the revealing of the mystery of Yahweh that's going to be completed. There is a mystery here, people, and a lot of people don't understand this, and this is why I'm doing this series here, or as we're leading into the seventh month, because the witnesses are involved in this mystery. The body of Christ is involved in this mystery, which are the children of the resurrection. But there is another part when God gathers his people Israel to fulfill what has been prophesied out of the Old Testament, that he has not cast off his people Israel, that one would come and deliver out of Zion to save his people Israel, and that will also be fulfilled. But they all have an order to them. You can't just bundle them all together, shake it up, and you think you're this and this and this and all apply. God's got an exact orderly arrangement. Okay, we're going to first go to 1 Corinthians, and we're going to look at the word mystery here. And we'll look at a few of these verses. Very, very important. First Corinthians, First Corinthians 2:7. Now I want to say to all of those viewing this video or watching a DVD of this or whatever, that there I could teach a long time just on a few of these verses, people. So this is kind of just giving you an outlay or an overlay, but hopefully you get a foundation out of this, because there is hours upon hours of teaching on this mystery. But just I want you to see what Paul is conveying overall about this mystery. But I do want you to understand that there is a tremendous amount of teaching in what Paul is talking about here. The narrative is the same, but there is a whole lot of teaching here. Okay, 2 Corinthians 2, verse 7. Well, let's pick it up in verse 6. Okay, howbeit we speak wisdom of them that are, well, my computer's acting like it's wanting to jump around now. I hope it don't mess up on us. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery. This is verse 7, when we back up to 6. Howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are complete. This don't mean perfect, y'all. This just means they understand. That's why Paul's saying we speak that are complete, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor the princes of this world that come to naught. See? But we speak the wisdom of God in mystery, the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory, the ones that understand the mystery, people. You got to see what Paul's talking about here. In other words, now when you're looking at this word ordained or God predefined, that's pro origo. This is predestination, people. A limit in advance that is predetermined, determined before, ordained, predestinate. Pro origo. Now, there again, I've said We get our word horizon from prorizo in the Greek. And there again, the sun, when the sun, the commencement of a day is when that sun sits down on the horizon or the horizon as it goes down. That's the conclusion of a day. And see, we've been predestinated to that, in other words. And this is all comes out when he says, I will raise you at the last day. We're finding out that that's what Paul's talking about, at the last day, last trump. That's when that sun sits on that 364th day on Enoch's calendar. As that sun commences on that day, and it's just a twinkling of a time, people, when that sun starts to go down before the horizon. Once it breaks that horizon, then we're into a new day. So it's a very short time. It's got to sit on it, and it's got to go below it. So it can't be right above it, and it can't break the horizon, the horizon. Very important there. Okay, now, so let's look at another verse here. Let's look at 1 Corinthians 4:1. So let's go to 1 Corinthians, the 4th chapter, and verse 1. And let me go back to Messianic. So let each one think of us in this way, as the Messiah, helpers and stewards of the mysteries of God. In this case, moreover, what is required of the stewards is to be found trustworthy. Trustworthy to the mysteries. See, now, Paul uses this in a plural. What did Christ say in Matthew 13 in his parable? It wasn't given to them to know the mysteries to the kingdom. But to you, if you got eyes to see and ears to hear, that means you have come, been born again, doing the will of the Father, and then you're worshiping Him in spirit and truth and obedience, then you understand the mysteries. It's given to you to understand the mysteries. It's given to you then to teach and preach these mysteries. And that's what Paul's talking about here, people. This is a completely different teaching than when Ezekiel talks about Son of Man prophesy and take one stick to Judah and one stick to Joseph or Ephraim. And they will be one stick, and I'll be one shepherd, and there'll be one nation, and I'll be king over them. That is a very true prophecy, and I teach that. So if anybody says I am not teaching that, you're incorrect. I will teach that. If somebody emails me and wants to know all about that, or when I do teach that, then you'll understand. But that's not the mystery that Paul's talking about, people. Now this might offend some people out there in the two houses that teach the two houses. I understand that. But if you'll follow the teaching, you're going to see that there is a different order. Those that Christ gathers when he sits his feet on the Mount of Olives, he's already gathered the children of the resurrection. He's already raised them. He did that 14 days earlier. And we're going to prove all that by the calendar and by the scripture. So there's two different things, and that's why Christ said, if you be found worthy to be raised from the dead, then you will be called the sons of God, the children of the resurrection. Now, Israel is called the sons or the children of God, but they're not, when he's talking about gathering those in the end, they are not gathered through resurrection, people. They're gathered when the earthquake hits and makes a way for them to walk over seven places there over the Egyptian Sea to walk and come back into the land. See, they are gathered on the earth. Now, I'll give you one hint. When we're changed in a moment, twinkling an eye, or those that are alive remained are changed, and the dead rise first, where does Where do we meet Christ? Where do we meet Him? We meet Him in the heavens. We meet Him in the air, in the clouds. So there's a meeting for the children of the resurrection. And guess what? There'll be a gathering for the earthly. There'll be a gathering for His people, Israel. Now, I'm going to bring all that in, and I don't need to say no more on that. But when we get into this a little further, then you'll come to see that. So I'm not teaching something that's out of order. I'm teaching what's in order. That's what Christ said about you're called the children of the resurrection. You're going to have, in the millennium, you're going to have angelic people, beings, angels. That's why He said you're like an angel. That's why He said you do not marry and give in marriage. That's why you understand we will not, those that are found worthy, will not be marrying and having children. Now there's a lot of difference in one of the prophecies prophesied, children being born, Israelite babies being born in the millennium. There will not, no child be born with a curse or any kind of disease in the millennium. No child will be born with a defect or a disease or anything. They're going to be born complete. A child 100 years old, even though he's disobedient or cursed, he'll be a child that Isaiah says will be 100 years old. But I'm going to throw this question to you. If you're part of the body of the Messiah and you've been raised from the dead, is that going to be any of your children? Christ has already told you that we're not going to have any kids. So who are all of these Israelite remnant people that He's going to gather at the seventh trump when He sets His feet on the Mount of Olives and the great earthquake happens, and He saves the tents of Judah first and then Ephraim, and then they come back in the land and they will prosper, long life, many, many children will be birthed. Now, all I want to say is that you? Are you paying attention to the Messiah? Or do you not understand the mystery? Okay, let's continue here. All right, so we see that here Paul is talking about the mystery again. As we go into 4:1, let's go to 1 Corinthians 13:2. 13:2. Okay, I speak with the tongues of men and angels ever not love. Okay. If I have the gift of prophecy and know all mysteries and all knowledge, and I have all faith so that as to remove mountains, this is not talking about physical mountains, people. It's talking about making mountains of self, getting rid of your opinions, the strongholds that have us in bondage. But have not love, I am nothing. Now, what you got to understand here, this word love is not phileo. It says nothing to do with phileo or compassion, that type of love. This word right here, love, is agape. It's affectionate, it's in a love feast. It actually means keeping His commandments, see. In other words, Paul is saying, if you know all the mysteries and everything, but you have not following His commandments or His fellowship with others, with like-minded people, you're nothing. So to know the mysteries and the knowledge and not do what He says, that's what Paul's talking about here. It has nothing to do that your affectionate love for your brother is talking about walking in obedience to the commandments with your brethren. But if you're not being obedient, then Paul says, even though I know all of the prophecies, I'm not anything. And that's true, because we follow and follow the Messiah and everything and teach the mysteries And we do that in by following and following His divine days and His holy days. So, but I wanted you to see, people get mixed up on this word love here. This is not phileo love, people. This is commandment love here. If you don't do the follow the commandments, no matter how smart you are on anything, Paul says, it doesn't mean anything. Okay, now I want to go back to 1 Corinthians. Let's look at 15:51. We've talked about this. So let's go to 15:51. And Paul brings in the mystery here again about the resurrection. Okay, 15:51. Okay, right here. Behold, he says, behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump there, it should be actually the word trump, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. So far is not correct here, because you got silver trumpets and you got the shofar here. Actually, you'll see it does the when you do a word study on that, you'll see the difference in a ram's horn and the trumpet. And so it's trumpet here. It's not the ram's horn. Now, the shofar is very important. That's God's trumpet that is blowed, the ram's horn, but that's not the trumpet it's talking about here. Okay, so here's part of the mystery, the resurrection at the last day, the last trump. Okay, all right, let's we'll get into some very interesting verses here. Ephesians 1:9. Ephesians 1 in verse 9, Paul reveals very deep spiritual understanding and to these assemblies here. Okay, 1:9. Having made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in him, in the Messiah. Now notice, for the administration of the fullness of the times, this is his divine days, capitulating, or when this fullness comes, that's the word actually means to sum up, when the completion of this time comes, all in Christ, things in heaven, notice the order, in the heavens, and then the things on the earth in himself. Now here's the order. We will be coming back. This is a very, 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 very important prophecy scripture that has to do with the two silver trumpets. We will see this when why Paul wrote this, people. Just give me time to get to it. But remember, the administration of the fullness of times, when this fullness of times comes, the mystery is completed. But see, when John's measuring the temple, those that worship therein in spirit and truth, we still got 3.5 years to go. The fullness of times hadn't come when the two witnesses stand up. We still got 3.5 years to go before that mystery is completed. In the days of the sounding of the seventh trump, then that mystery will be completed. So when they stand up in those days, but we got 3.5 years to go. So very important here. Now notice, this is unbelievable. And also, you were chosen by lot, being predestined according to the intention of the one, operating all according to the counsel of his own will. This word operating, people, in the Greek, this word operating, energia, it means his operation. You see, we get our word energy from the word Greek word energia. So it's God's operation. It's his energia. It's His energy that is conforming us. See, He's the one that cast the lot. He's the one that and created the holy days. He's the one that sent His Son. He's the one that gives us a new birth. He's the one that grants us repentance. He's the one that grants us faith. He's the one that grants us grace. And see, once He does that, then we are led by His Spirit, being conformed to the Son's image. This is all God's Yah's operation energy in us. We've been predetermined, fitted up in advance, that we should walk in these times, people. This is the spiritual language that Paul has given. You got to understand this. I mean, but the point being is, how can I say this? When the Sunday so-called church, and most of us have to come from there, we're called out of there to come to His truth. Now they're seeing people going back to the Torah, the prophets, and the Psalms, and they're learning the feast days, they're learning how important the Sabbath is, they're learning His calendar, and now, you know, there's some of us now are teaching this mystery. Okay, but when you have Sunday preachers, fundamentalists or whatever type of denomination, they say that we're sinning because we're trying to keep the law. Or they say that it's your works, and our works are as filthy rags, the Bible says. That's true. But see, what they don't understand were this, what they're blinded to, that you have to have a new birth. You have to be regenerated by God's Spirit as to regenerate new birth or reconciliation as far as reestablishing your spirit to follow Him, to follow His Spirit. See, because we lost that in the garden with Adam. That's why there's been a new birth. Israel could not follow the letter of the law. So we have to have a new birth. So we are not under the law. We have been set free. How? Through the Spirit. That's why it's paramount that you understand. That's what they don't understand. When you're born of the Spirit, then God writes that. So it's not, it's His operation in you. See, that's the mystery. It's an operation in you that you're being conformed to like Christ. Christ followed the Father, prayed to Him and the Spirit. He prayed and the Father taught Him even obedience to the cross. So the point I'm saying is, it's the same, it's in the same context. We're born of the Father's Spirit, and then He gives us to Christ to follow. And we're being conformed to that image, see? We're being created in the Messiah. That's a new create. That's the difference in the renewed and the old. We're being created through the Spirit, see? But it's still following His divine days and Sabbath. So when we do the Sabbath or follow the divine days, they want to say, "You're that's works. You're under the law. That's sin unless you keep the whole law." They don't understand. I'm trying to convey to the ones that hear what the Spirit is saying to the assemblies. If you understand, then you understand. If you got eyes to see and ears to hear, that means spiritually you understand what I'm saying. To them, they're not going to understand because they see that's works of the law. They don't see that is Christ, God, working in you, the hope of glory, the mystery, Christ in a man or woman. They don't see that. Okay, so here we've got this unbelievable stuff that Paul is talking about here. And this is God's operation. And this was predestined before the foundation of the world. And now he's fulfilling what he had said before times. For to be His high praise of His glory of the ones hoping earlier in the Christ, in whom also you haven't heard the word of the truth, the good news of your deliverance, in whom also have trusted, you were sealed by the Spirit of promise, the Holy. So we've been given a seal of down payment through the Spirit in this mystery. So very, very important, people. All right, now I want to go a couple more here. Let's look in Ephesians 3rd chapter. Ephesians 3. And let's look at the 3rd verse. Let me go back here to Messianic. 3rd verse. That the mystery was made known to me by revelation as I wrote before briefly. So Paul is teaching us, people, we got to know what they knew. There was a good friend of mine that died of cancer a few years ago. I studied with this man for 10 years. He was from Alabama. We studied online and visited each other and studied the scripture. And right before he died, he said, Larry, he said, there's things that the apostles know that the Lord hadn't showed us yet. There's things they know that we do not know. And I said, and I agree, this was several years ago. And I said, we just got to keep following and praying, and that we will end up knowing what they know. And now I could say, if he was alive, I could sit down with him and talk to him about these unbelievable things the Lord's revealed. But not at that time. So we've got to know, people, and the Lord is revealing this. He's revealing these things to us. He's revealing the resurrection of the dead. This is part of the mystery. But everybody don't see that, and I understand that. But for those that do see, then Paul is talking to you, because he's telling you this is what we have to do. We have to do. The people that he's going to gather are not even in covenant with him, people. They don't even believe in the Messiah. I'm talking about the ones the remnant he's going to gather there in Isaiah 11 when he brings his people out the second time. So there's an order to all of this. Okay, now, so the mystery's made known to me, revelations I wrote briefly. When you read this, you can understand my insight into the mystery of the Messiah. Which was, now notice here, people, I'm just reading you, I wanted you to see what these verses are saying. Which was not made known to the sons of men in other generations, as it has now been revealed by the Ruach to his holy emissaries and prophets. This is a mystery, people. This mystery is that the Gentiles are joint heirs and fellow members of the same body and co-heirs of the promise in Messiah Yeshua through the good news. But the mystery, the Gentiles grafted in to the commonwealth of the 12 tribes is the mystery. The Gentiles. Now, please understand when I say this. There is messianic people that believe in the Messiah. They're in the same, it's sad because most of them don't understand this mystery. They teach the Messiah, they believe he's a Jewish Messiah and he's coming back, and they believe that. But they're not really following this good news about the resurrection saints that he raised 2,000 years ago. But the prophecy that's going to be at the end, when he gathers the two houses, when he sits his feet and he puts his arm out the second time for the remnant of his people, that's a completely different prophecy than what Paul's talking about here, people. Okay, so let me continue here. I've got just a few more verses. 3-4. Let's look here at 3. 9. All right, 3:9. And to bring to light the plan of the mystery, which for ages was hidden in God who created all things. So this was hidden, people, for the ages. It was hidden in Yah, who created all. This was, now what are we supposed to do? To preach the mystery, which is the plan, the mystery that's been hidden. So, the purpose is that through Messiah's community, the multifaceted wisdom of God might be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places, which is keeping with the eternal purpose that he carried out in Messiah Yeshua our Lord. Okay, I want to go to Ephesians 5:32. Ephesians 5:32. Okay, Ephesians 5:32. Okay. This mystery is great, but I am talking about Messiah and his community. The other translation here is his body. See? So, in any case, let each of you love his own wife as himself, and let the wife respect her husband. Then he goes into talking about man and wife here. So there's mystery is about Messiah and his body. Ephesians 6:19. Ephesians 6:19. And pray for me, Paul says, when I open my mouth to make known the boldness of the mystery of the good news. See? So this boldness of the good news of the mystery is that there's going to be a trumpet that's going to go off, and it's going to be on a certain day, which is the last day at the last trump. And those that are found worthy or doer, they are going to be given authority over the nations to rule them. The 12 apostles are going to rule the 12 tribes of the children of Israel. That's what Christ said in Matthew 19:28. Paul tells you in 1 Corinthians 6:2 and 6:3 that we will judge the nations and judge angels. So this is why there is that God is bringing this mystery, because those are going to be his, I'm going to use this word as I bring out, they are his princesses out of the Old Testament that I will bring to light that what those verses and where you find some of those verses. All of this, people, is I'm trying to just lay a foundation to bring in, because we're right here at the coming end of the feast of the Lord in the seventh month. And we've got trumpets and then a day of atonement and tabernacles. So it's very important, because the witnesses, we're going to see what day they're going to stand up. Or what divine date. I'm not saying what year they're going to stand up. I'm talking about the day they're going to stand up. So this is very important, and I know it could be hard for some that might be listening to this. But just, it's really not hard once you understand there's going to be people that's going to be raised from the dead, and they're going to be like angels. There's going to be a huge remnant of God's people that are going to be earthly beings that are going to fulfill the prophecies that were written by the prophets in the Old Testament. But they're both not the same. We're all going to be together, but our functions are going to be different. You're going to have angelic beings with earthly beings. And that's why Paul said in Ephesians 1:10, he'll gather all things in heaven. Then he's going to gather all things on earth. Heavenly beings, angels, angelic beings, earthly beings is two different things, people. But there are two prophecies that God will bring together, and he will bring us into unification there when he comes back. Okay, there's a couple of verses in Colossians, and I'm going to close. These are awesome verses here in Colossians. And we're going to look in verse 126. Colossians 1:26. Colossians 1:26. The mystery that was hidden from the ages and generations, but now has been revealed to his saints here. His kadoshim, which is his saints here. Very important, right here, to his saints here. The set apart ones. That's the King James. Polyglot says, to his holy ones here. All right, now we look in Colossians 1:27. Once to whom God wanted to make known what the wealth of the glory of his mystery among the nations, Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of the glory. So there's a mystery. Christ in a man, the hope of glory, the mystery of the Gentiles, once they come in or birthed and doing the will of the Father, they're in Christ. And this is a mystery, and they are the ones that will be found worthy to be raised from the dead. But they got to be doing the will of the Father. The will of the Father, people, is to follow the divine days, to teach the Logos in season. Noukeros and out of season, Akeros, means his divine times, whom we announce, admonishing every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we should present every man complete in the Messiah. In other words, Paul is saying, if we teach every man complete in the Messiah, and they're doing the will of the Father, then they're going to get their rewards in that day. They're going to be raised from the dead at the last trump, at the last day. That's what Paul is saying. Colossians 2:2, and this is the last verse. Colossians 2:2. Okay. That their hearts should be comforted, being instructed in love. This is his commandments right here. This is when Paul says we don't have this and know all prophecies that don't mean anything. Being instructed in love, in agape, in his commandments, instructed. What does that mean? To drive together, reduplication, that is unite, associate, affection. That means show, teach, compact, assuredly, gather, instruct, knit, together, prove. In all riches of the full assurance of the understanding and full knowledge of the mystery, people. The mystery of God and the Father and of the Messiah. So the mystery of God the Father and of the Messiah, and this is what we're teaching. This is now, hopefully, those of you in this video that you understand some of the things that I've laid out here, but I wanted you to see some scriptures and that word necessary and the mystery. And as we get closer here, you're going to see the mystery. It is a mystery, people. But once you rightly divide and see, when Christ says, if you're found worthy, you're like angels. You don't die anymore, but you don't marry, and you're not given in marriage. Then he says over here, this prophecy will be fulfilled, because I'm going to come out of Zion. And the last thing he told Jerusalem, that I often have you chicks together, my chicks, and put them under my wings, you would have it not. Your house is left desolate. But the next time you see me, you will see me coming in clouds with power and great glory, and say, blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord. That prophecy is not the children of the resurrection. That, and when this is complete, this whole mystery, children of resurrection, blessed thee comes in the name of the Lord, will be in unification. May the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, may that spirit witness your spirit. We trade these scriptures with one another. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, soon coming King. Amen.